Macmillan Audio presents Man of the Year by Lou Cove. Read for you by Fred Berman. It contributes greatly toward a man's moral and intellectual health to be brought into habits of companionship with individuals unlike himself, who care little for his pursuits and whose sphere and abilities he must go out of himself to appreciate. There was one man especially, the observation of whose character gave me a new idea of talent. Nathaniel Hawthorne. If I'm going to be Starsky, then you're going to have to be my Hutch. Howie Gordon. Part 1. Cover Story. At home in Salem. What the hell are we doing in Salem? The town famous for torching neighbors who seemed anything other than Puritan. We're not just strangers. We're Jews. Sure, we're unobservant, nonconformist, free-thinking New York Jews in paisley-patched dungarees. But still, we're so very other, and so very wandering. Nice to meet you, Salem, Massachusetts. We'll be gone soon. It's our 8th move in 12 years. But none of the first 7 were nearly as bleak. Everything about Salem is different than Manhattan, right from the break of day. No noise, no cars, no life until the Salem dads emerge from their front doors, suited up and shuffling to the train for the slow weekday ride to Boston. They are followed by the sockless, dock-sider-wearing sea captain wannabes, unshaven and still bleary from the rum scrum of the night before. They buy fresh bread and weak coffee at the Athens bakery, drag on long brown cigarettes on their way to their boats or their private painting studios, avoiding the gaze of the dudes cruising rusty Camaros and booming Jethro Tull and Black Sabbath, gunning for their morning dog's hair at the Pig's Eye. But on Sunday mornings, these streets are empty. I ride alone. I deliver papers, and not that well. At 6:30 each Sunday, my alarm buzzes, and a fresh pile of North Shore Sundays, bound with wire and wrapped in plastic, waits for me on the front steps. I grab a t-shirt, the striped jeans I wore yesterday, a marblehead zip sweatshirt, and my canvas paper bag. Adja, our dog, is still settled by the foot of my bed in the same Sunday rhythm reserved for the rest of the Cove family. Her black lids rise wearily when I open the door, ice blue eyes indifferent. The North Shore Sunday has just enough original content to merit being called a newspaper, but it's otherwise filled with advertisements for the butcher sale at the A&P, marine supplies, and cordwood delivery. People don't pay for it. The only person who seems to care if it shows up is Mr. Getchell, my route supervisor. But I still try to get tips for delivering it when I can. Outside, it looks as if the cold mist might give way. I snip the rigid newspaper bindings with the wire cutter crotch of my pliers. The news of the week is a mix of global import and local fluff. The Vatican denies foul play but refuses to conduct an autopsy on Pope John Paul I. The Marblehead Squirts hockey team made the cover after a visit to Quebec. Peter Frampton is still recovering from his car accident. I fill the stiff paperboy bag with my burden. I hate this. Every part of it. Waking up early, balancing as I ride, the sack cutting into my shoulder like a claw, rolling through the haunted streets alone, forced into neighborhoods that smell like damp ashtrays. I rarely finish the job, and now towers of undelivered papers teeter in my closet and sop up rabbit tinkle and bunny yabba's wooden crate in the center of my room. The first few weeks, I threw maybe 20 or 30 copies in there, just the last couple of streets worth. As the weather got colder, I started quitting the route 3/4 of the way in, then halfway. I shamble out back, where my Apollo waits by a rose bush. It's a Ross. 5-speed, stout, rugged tires, white walls, chrome fenders, banana seat, and easy rider handlebars. The saving grace of any paper route morning. This is the 8th time I've had to move. 8th! Mama and Papa keep trying to convince us that Moving to Salem is a great achievement. The realization of a long-held dream to return to the place of their youth, the North Shore of Massachusetts, and to do so in spectacular fashion. Mama, who grew up nearby in Lynn, the city of sin, you never come out the way you went in, spent months shopping for a house in Marblehead. That's the next town over from Salem, where Papa grew up, and where his parents, Grandma Winnie and Grandpa Sam, still live. We've ended up just a few miles away from them, and that's really the only good thing I can say about leaving our apartment on West End Avenue in New York. It needs to be something historical, something old, Mama had said over the phone to the realtor, who couldn't produce anything close to my parents' price range in the dense, clabbered cluster of houses along Marblehead's sparkling harbor. Would you consider living in Salem? The realtor had asked, as Mama calculated mortgage rates on a piece of pink scrap paper. There's only one street I would consider living on in Salem, and that's Chestnut Street, she answered, believing this wasn't an option. Well, then you better come and see this house. It's the most beautiful street in America, Mama told us, and I'm not the only one who feels that way. Apparently it was true, because Papa had said the same thing over the phone to me when he heard that Mama was going to look at 31 Chestnut. It's the most beautiful street in America, he said cheerily. Magazine worthy, you'll see. Who says that? I asked Mama, wondering what was so bad about the first street we lived on, or the fourth, or the seventh. Who says it's the most beautiful? And why do we need to live somewhere beautiful? Riverside Park is beautiful. So was Washington, D.C. and Westport, Connecticut, and New York the first time around. It is, said Mama. And it smells like someone peed all over it. This is a better place to grow up. You'll see. Our house is one of three brick homes pressed into one, side by side. A gift from a Salem sea merchant to his three daughters. Our part, the left third of the manor, has three sprawling floors, all of which show their age. 7,300 square feet! Papa never tires of proclaiming, whatever that means. There are seven bedrooms, five bathrooms, a haunted attic, and an entire apartment hidden behind an unlocked swinging door in the disproportionately small galley kitchen. My sister Amanda and I run the length of the house when we first arrive, through not one, but two living rooms, craning to see the dust bunnies and dead flies caught in the cobwebs dangling from the impossibly high ceilings. There are fireplaces in nearly every room and a gigantic basement, once the servants' kitchen, with a wooden dumbwaiter at one end. It could still be used to transport toys and snacks, but no kids, to the little kitchen above by way of a thick, oily rope worn smooth by decades of calloused hands sending dishes and meals up and down. Every room shows its age, wallpaper drooping and bubbled, signs of water recently dribbled from under the crown moldings and ceiling medallions, and fractures in all the wood floors which promise legendary splinters. The truth is, my father didn't want to leave New York. He loved the hustle, distraction, and music of the streets. He delighted in discovering the next cheese, cigar, smoked fish, or magic trick shop. He lived for the museums, the movie theaters, and his work. His enthusiasm for life in that city was infectious. My mother shared no such feelings. The only way he was able to convince her to move back to New York, the city of my birth, was to promise the eventual return to shtetl life in one of the seaside towns on the North Shore. 2 years in the city, he told her. That's all I need to reach the next level. It took three, but she prevailed. From the outside, our new home suggests a great triumph. But wealthy as we may appear to the tourists who goggle at the towering manners of Chestnut Street, they can't see the leaky ceilings and exposed horsehair plaster from the outside. And they can't see the apartment we need to rent to Frank, our spectacularly hairy and exultantly gay tenant, who is Papa's fraternity brother in college. This little bit of neglect is how we could afford to buy it, Mama said. And the rent is how we'll afford to keep it. Their relief was evident when Frank, a blast from Papa's past, answered the ad in the Salem Evening News. I sling the bag over my shoulder, roll the bike back along the brick walkway, and saddle up on an empty Chestnut Street. Rolling east, up Flint and across Essex, knocking off the scarier sections by Route 107 before the weirdos over there wake up.
Grandpa Sam had a paper route when he was a boy,
Grandma Winnie told me when I got mine.
He always tried to stay one step behind the milkman, who also made deliveries before dawn. My Sammy would get to the stoop and open up those fresh bottles of milk so he could sip the cream off the top. If it was too cold out, the cream would freeze and he was out of luck. If that happened, he would go to the homes that got their rolls delivered from the bakery. Can you imagine him? Poor hungry Fagala.
He's not gay, I say, confused.
Oh, Fagala, silly. It's Yiddish for little bird. Where do you hear such things?
Gramps never told me about his paper route or the cream thing himself. But Gramps never tells me much besides what's for supper and what's in the TV guide.
There's a new show on next Sunday, Big Lou. It's about a fellow with bionic arms and legs and eyes. Why don't you come over and watch with me?
I deliver most of the papers and start to close the loop of my route, led by my nose toward the yeasty smell of Athens Bakery's bread wafting through the neighborhood. I stop pedaling at the corner of Botts and Essex, one house away from Gretchen's. She's the only girl in this new neighborhood who's willing to talk to me. Willing, but not necessarily wanted. Gretchen, always showing up unexpectedly, usually sitting too close for comfort. She's 12, too, but instead of attending my school, Oliver, she goes to some experimental place on the other side of town.
For cool kids,
she boasted once.
They might let you in.
I could turn home now and avoid her altogether, but before I can decide, I see her face flash in an upstairs window and I know she's been waiting for me. Gretchen motions frantically to stay put, so I wait out front. She's talking before the door even slams behind her.
Did you finish your route?
I shake my head. Just taking a break. It's not warm enough for shorts today, but she's wearing them anyway. She sits on the brick path to her little house and motions for me to join. When she crosses her legs, I can see the top of her thigh. All milk, slipping away into a darker fold of her khakis.
See the love boat last night?
She asks. I shake my head again and she flaps her legs like a bird. And there it is, the yellow cotton panel of her panties, revealing skin more ginger pink than the flesh of her leg.
Arnold was on it.
From Happy Days?
Yep.
She nods knowingly, looks down between her legs, then back at me.
Get a good look?
I feel a spring of panic and quickly look away from her crotch to the witch house in the distance. They call it that, as if it were the home of Tituba or Sarah Good, but Mama says it is actually the house of a wealthy Puritan judge who participated at their infamous trials. Papa says everyone in Salem has an angle. I look back, and Gretchen is smiling, dropping her knees a little farther so the cuff of her khaki short gives an additional, breathtaking quarter of an inch or more. And then she slides a finger to her panties and moves the yellow fabric aside. Shame buys with thrill. I want to see. I don't want to know. I stand up, certain a Puritan judge is rounding the corner with a thorny switch. Gotta finish the route.
I don't care, you know. If you want to look, I mean.
I know, I nod, straddling the Apollo. I just have to go. I make a few more deliveries, pop out the north side of the cemetery, and catch the smell of the ocean breeze, skipped like a stone off the wharf toward Gallows Hill, carrying all those damp Salem odors. Papa's asleep when I return. Mama's tinkering in the basement. I enter quietly, softly walking the steps to my room. I stash the overflow in the closet, drop a few pellets of food in between the pellets of poop in Bunny Yabba's crate, and return to the top bunk for a visit with Barbie Benton. If Gramps noticed the missing Barbie issues from his Playboy collection in his downstairs bathroom, he never hinted at it. Here, she's looking over her shoulder at me, looking up from her poolside sunbathing, turning away from her stained glass window to meet my eyes, rising up from her bed of furs. The brunette Breck girl, but naked. Barbara Gordon minus her shiny purple Batgirl cowl. May 72 is Barbie at her best. Auburn hair and bangs taking up the entire cover, those incredible eyes, black but exploding with sparks of slate blue and white light, flawless chiclet teeth that flash a smile, girl next door, but more.
Entertainment. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.